Let prayer as we kneel. Oh Lord, today, this coming week, we celebrate your earthly birth when you came to save us and you took on human mankind. We commemorate this wonderful event. Traditionally, we have chosen this time of year. Lord, we are just so thankful that you came to tabernacle with us. We are so thankful that as our Passover lamb, you took on our sins and died on the cross for us, that we might have the promise of salvation. And we are so grateful that you rose from the dead and ascended to heaven as the first fruits, and took with you saints as a pledge of the first fruits of the great harvest of believers when you come again, that you will take home with you. And we thank you that you sent your Holy Spirit at Pentecost prepare believers for that great harvest. Oh Lord, we're just astounded that these events all took place on the very day that our Heavenly Father had proclaimed as the holy day of Passover, the holy day of first fruits, the holy day of harvest. More than 1,400 years toward your earthly birth. Lord, now we hear your warning trumpets, and we eagerly look forward to your soon return, when we will be at one with you, and you will take us home to tabernacle with you forever and ever in your kingdom. Until then, dear Lord, please help us to be dedicated ambassadors for you. And Lord, today we pray for our members who cannot be with us because of illness or otherwise. Pray for Hugh and Benny, the difficulties they have been through. I'm so happy that they can be with us today. We pray for Jim Belus, his financial needs, the application that he has made is still pending. Pray for Mark's cousin, who's had a severe burn, quick healing. And for Gabriel, his father, life quick healing for him also. Lord, we pray that this service will be pleasing to you. We ask all this in your mighty name. Amen.
Keeping watch over their flocks by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ Jesus the Lord. And this will be the sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger." And suddenly, there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him. When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all of the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he inquired of them, asking them where the Christ was to be born. So they said to him, in Bethlehem, O Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, but you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not the least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. Then Herod, when he had secretly called the wise men, determined from them what time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and search carefully for the young child, and when you have found him, bring back word to me, that I may come and worship him also. When they heard the king, they departed, and behold, the star which they had seen in the east went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Then, being divinely warned in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed their own country another way.
The offering this morning was the church budget. We all know how expensive it is to maintain our own homes. The church has definite needs of maintenance, new sound equipment. There's definitely a lot of church to be helpful. We want to keep the church beautiful as it is. So the deacons, please rise.
Isn't it true that some of the most beautiful music that has ever been written or ever been sung or played is Christmas music? Would you agree? And that is because the most amazing event that has ever happened in this world happened when we celebrate this time of year. Jesus becoming a baby in Bethlehem's manger. An amazing event, but you know, it's so easy to just go through the motions and not think about that, what that really means to us. The other night, my wife and I attended a school play, not our school on this side, it was on the other side of the island. And the young man that played the leading part did it last year as well. He knew his lines so well, you could tell he hardly had to think about it. And so when he quoted Ephesians 2 verses 6 through 8, beautiful passage about salvation by grace, he said, we're not saved by grace, we're saved by works. Very confident. And he didn't catch it, but I caught it. And at the very end, the punchline was about Jesus saving us, and he said, and we save ourselves. Yeah, sometimes at this time of year, we listen to the music, we remember the story, but we don't stop to think about what it really means to us, what it means for our life, what it means for our hearts, our salvation. And so I want to talk about that just for a few minutes this morning. The song that Charlene sang so beautifully just now said, fall on your knees. Oh, hear the angel voices. Oh, night divine. Oh, night when Christ was born. Oh, night divine. Oh, holy night divine. The Creator became human, became a baby, Creator of the universe. It's not just that it happened, but it is why it happened that we need to think about. And so let's begin where the song began that we just heard. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared, and the soul felt its worth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining. Pining is an old word that means grieving for a lost love with a broken heart. Yearning for something that has been lost. Pining. Is there anyone here today who is pining? You've come to church. You've enjoyed the Christmas program. But are you pining? Are you pining the loss of dreams? Are you pining the illness of a loved one? Are you pining the loss of a love? Are you pining the loss of innocence? Are you pining? Long lay the world in sin and error pining. We lost our innocence when sin came into the world, and we also lost our worth because sin leads to a loss of worth. Many in the world were convinced that they were too sinful or too shameful for God to love them. But Jesus came to tell us how much God loved us. And he came as a baby. He came as one of us to tell us, to show us, to show us that God loved us. Jesus came to say that no matter how sinful we have become, no matter how far from God, no matter how worthless we seem in our own eyes, no matter how many questions we have about God, no matter if we are even angry or in rebellion against God, God still loves us. You see, he came into the middle of our sin. He came into the middle of our dark world. God still thinks we're worth enough to sacrifice everything for. And to show what he meant, he took a poor woman who had lost her dignity and restored her with his love. She poured perfume all over his head to thank him. He took a man whom everybody looked down on and made him one of his 12 main disciples. And to thank Jesus, Matthew wrote the story that we remember at Christmas time. He took a couple of angry brothers and showed them his love. He was patient with them. He saw the reasons for their anger, and he kept on loving them. And John refers to himself as the disciple who Jesus kept on loving. In the Greek language, Jesus never gave up. He kept on loving. And so, friends, today, if you came feeling shame, if you came doubting your worth, if you came discouraged, if you came angry, if you came disillusioned, God loves you. And he proved it by sending his son as a baby in Bethlehem's manger. Truly, he taught us to love one another. His law is love, and his gospel is peace. Jesus taught us to love each other by coming into this world. You know, we have a hard time with that. We look at people and we judge them. We judge them by the way they look, by the way they act, by their lifestyle, by the things they do or they don't do. Scripture says in the Old Testament that when Jesus came, he did not judge by the seeing of his eyes or the hearing of his ears. He judged in righteousness. What did that mean? Jesus looked into the heart of each person he met. He looked beneath the surface. Aren't you thankful that Jesus does that? He doesn't judge us by the way we are, but by what's in our heart. And he taught us to love one another in the same way. You know, this nation, this world, is so much in need of the message of Christmas. We have come through a terrible period in the history of the United States. We've sunk to a new low. That was bad already. But this political season topped everything. There's too much hate, too much name calling, too much of everything. And the only person who lost was us. This nation, we lost. We lost because we lost character. We lost goodness. We lost kindness. And it's a warning to those of us who believe that the ends of the world are almost on us. The most telling event is not perhaps an event, but how we act toward one another, how we treat one another. Truly, he taught us to love one another. His law is love, and his gospel is peace. Jesus came into this world to bring the good news. Good news is something that you didn't know until you heard it. Jesus came to bring good news. The news that he brought was news that had been lost, had been obscured. It was the good news about his Father's character, the way God really is. You see, Satan had done a good job of obscuring the character of God, of distorting what God was really like. And so the nations of the world looked at God with fear. Their religions depicted him as a God of vengeance, a God of anger, only a God of judgment. And Jesus came to tell the truth about God. He came to show the character of his heavenly Father. It was good news. It was news that had been lost sight of. Jesus came to clear it up. Satan tried to put a mask on God's face, an angry mask, a judgmental mask, and Jesus came to take that mask off and show what God was really like. So Jesus came to live among us, and in the wonderful kindness that he showed, in the way he related to people, the people that society rejected, the people that society looked down on, the way Jesus related to those people showed the heart of God. That's why Jesus had to be made like us in every way, so that he could become a merciful and faithful minister for us. Because he was tempted in every way like we are, he can help us when we're tempted. You see, Jesus had to become us. He had to become us. Not just like us, he had to become us. So that he would know what it was like to be us in this world. The Bible says that he was tempted in every way like we are. He struggled with those temptations. He really struggled. It wasn't easy for him. Sometimes people think that, oh, he was God in human flesh, so he didn't really struggle. He wasn't really tempted. No, he was really tempted. He was tempted stronger than any one of us will ever be tempted. Satan knew that he was the one, that baby was the one, who had come to defeat him, who had come to win back the kingdom that he had stolen from God. And so from the cradle to the cross, Satan had been preparing for this showdown for thousands of years. And he and his fellow demons, those one-third of the angels that fell from heaven, they brought everything they had at Jesus Christ. And Jesus had to do what Adam failed to do. He had to live a perfect life without even the thought of sin. He had to do it in our humanity. And by God's grace, through depending on his Father, he did do that. Jesus lived a perfect life. And he did it to save us. He did it because none of us had ever done that. And our characters were like filthy rags. And so Jesus can take his perfect life and cover us when we put our trust in him. He can take our sins and forgive us because he died for those on the cross of Calvary. But he can do more than that. When we are tempted, he can sympathize with us because he was tempted and discouraged by the things that tempt and discourage us. He lost his father at a young age and had to take over the family business and support not only his mother, but his thankless stepbrothers and sisters. Oh yeah, Jesus had brothers and sisters. His daddy, stepdaddy, earthly daddy, Joseph, had a lot of children whom he left when he died, and Jesus had to take care of them. He had to earn a living. And they constantly criticized him because they said, oh, you think you're better than us. He was. Oh, you think you're so good. He was. You're too strict about following God's word. Thank God he was. Some of them became believers after Jesus died. And James, his brother, wrote about it in the book of James. And Jude, his brother, wrote about it in the book of Jude. And others. Fall on your knees. Worship this Creator who became the created to save you and me. To help us when we're discouraged, when we're tempted, when we're struggling. I'm so thankful today that Jesus hears every sincere prayer. The only prayer Jesus doesn't hear is the prayer that isn't prayed. Jesus hears every sincere prayer. And if we're struggling, if we don't know our future, if we don't know our worth, if we don't know how to get through our temptations, if we don't know how we'll ever make it to heaven, Jesus, born as a baby, grew up as a child, died as a young man, rose from the dead, and always lives to help us. He will help you.